Okay, so when we studied RC circuits, we mainly looked at a simple RC circuit where there would just be a battery with an EMF E and a resistor and a capacitor with a switch in it. In that case, we wrote a loop equation and we were able to get a solution for the charge. Charge increases with time, as shown, Q max times 1 minus e to the minus t over tau, and then the current decreases with respect to time exponentially. We saw all this. But if you have a circuit that looks like this, which is a little more complicated than a simple RC circuit, we could still write our loop equations, but it's not a simple RC circuit, so the currents would be coupled, right? So it takes a little more effort to solve those equations. However, we can look at some limiting conditions quite easily by trying to see how an RC circuit behaves in the simple RC circuit case, and then we can apply that to any RC circuit at two limiting conditions. One at t equals zero, right, when you close the switch. And then the second one is in steady state when you have left the switch on for a long time for steady state to be achieved. Okay. So before we get to this, I just want to talk a little bit about a simple RC circuit. So we see that if initially if the charge was zero on the capacitor, it's uncharged, and then you close the switch at time zero, then there will be a maximum current at time zero, right? And that's what is charging the capacitor, right? So the top will be positive and the bottom will be negative, and this charge keeps increasing with respect to time, right? But anyway, at time zero, since the charge on the capacitor is zero, we can say the voltage across the capacitor, which is Q divided by C, that's also zero, right? So if there is no voltage across the capacitor, that means for calculation purposes, you can treat the capacitor as a wire, right? You can replace the capacitor with a wire or a short, right? So at time zero, and with that, you can calculate the current in the circuit and voltage and so on, right? So the voltage is zero at time zero, so the capacitor can be replaced by a wire. If you wait for a very long time, which is what we are going to do in the second problem later, so if you wait for a very long time, the charge on the capacitor would be a maximum by that time, right? So it would have the maximum charge it can possibly have. So as t goes to infinity, the charge on the capacitor goes to a maximum value. And that means the current IC, current through the capacitor or in the branch where the capacitor is, that's the derivative of Q. And since Q goes to Q max, this goes to zero. We can also see this with this graph here, right, that the current becomes zero. So in steady state, right, in steady state, charge is a maximum and current is zero. And this tells you that you can treat a capacitor as a gap. So there will be no current in the branch where there is a capacitor, right? So those are the two main ideas that we use in trying to solve these kind of seemingly complicated circuits, but it becomes very easy in the limiting cases, right? So for example, in the first problem here, a capacitor is initially uncharged, switch is closed at time zero. What is the current through the battery, right? So they're asking for the current through the battery, right, as soon as the switch is closed. That means at time zero, okay? So this is where you say, okay, since it's at time zero, you have just closed the switch at time zero, which means there is no charge on this, no voltage across the capacitor, so you can replace it with a wire or you can short it up with a wire, right? So when you look at the currents, say for example, I is the current that's going through the battery, right? That's in this branch. There is a junction here. That's where it splits. There'll be a current I1 and I2. I'll call this current through this to be I1. and I'll call this to be I2. So the I1 basically bypasses the capacitor, right, and just goes through this. And at this junction, they join again. So your current I is equal to I1 plus I2. Right? So that's coming from the junction rule. I'll just call it equation 1. And what we need is current I, right? So that's what they want, the current through the battery. So they're asking for current I. Now, there is two ways to figure this out. You could either write your loop rules and then solve for the three unknowns, I and I2. Or you could recognize that without the capacitor here, the 40 and the 10 ohm are in parallel with each other, right? So these two are in parallel, and then that's in series with the 60 ohm resistor, right? So if I give these names, I'll call this R1, and this is R2, and this is R3. Then my R23, I can calculate, right, using 1 over R23 is 1 over 40 ohms plus 1 over 10. So you can see that's 4 over 10, 5 over 40, right, which means 1 over 8. So your R23 is really 8 ohms. So R23 is 8 ohms, so the equivalent resistance is the R1 plus the R23 because they are in series. So 60 ohms plus the 8 ohms, right? That's 68 ohms. And since all you need is the current through the battery, so this is really equivalent to, you know, you have your 100 volts across one equivalent resistance, right? This is the 100 volts. And your current is I that's flowing through that. So current I is just E over R equivalent, and your E is 100 volts divided by 68 ohms. And I believe I had calculated this before. Yeah, this is 1.47 amperes. And like I said, you can certainly write loop equation, get three equations for the three unknowns, and you can solve it that way as well. Okay, so that's the current through the battery as soon as you close the switch. Right. Now, if you wait for a very long time for steady state to reach, that's what's in the second problem here. The switch in the figure has been closed for a very long time. So this is closed. And it's closed for a very long time, which means steady state has reached, right? And in steady state, the capacitor would have got all the charge that it can get, whatever that is, we'll call it Q max, right? And that means when the charge is the maximum, there is no current that's flowing in that branch anymore. So we call this current I1. So I1 is actually zero. You see, that's the steady state current, and we call this current I, and this is the same current I that's coming here, and usually at the junction it would have broken into I2 and I1, but I1 is zero, so you can tell that I is just equal to I2. So the current is just basically, you know, flowing this way, right? Sorry, I didn't mean to do that. Yeah, so the current is just flowing this way. There is no current in this branch, you see. So, or in other words, the capacitor is like a gap. It doesn't draw any current. So now you can see, since the same current, so I is equal to I2, right? And I1 is zero. And you can see that if you write a loop equation, or if you just look at the equivalent resistance here, R equivalent is 60 and 40 are in series, so that's a 100 ohm resistor, you see, 100 ohm resistors. So the current I, which is also equal to I2, it's nothing but E over R equivalent, and that is 100 volts divided by 100 ohms, and that's just 1 ampere, okay? So there's a 1 ampere current that's flowing through this. But that's not what we were asked. We were asked to find the charge on the capacitor. You see? So we need the charge on the capacitor. So there's a couple of different ways you can go about it. Perhaps the easiest thing to do is just to write a loop equation. I can write a loop equation for the big loop here, right? So I'll say big loop, and I decide to go clockwise around the loop, starting at the battery. So I have 100 volts, and then along the current, so minus IR, minus I times R, that's 60 ohms, right? And then it would have been minus I1 times R, that's 10 ohms. But I1 is 0, so this term is 0, right? And then I'm going through the capacitor, so it will be a negative Q divided by C. But in steady state, Q is Q max. And then I'm back to where I started, so that's equal to 0, you see? And this current I is 1 ampere. We have this, that's equal to 1 ampere. So you can see that Q max divided by C is nothing but 100 minus 60, right? 100 minus 60, which is 40 volts, you see? And we could have also seen that by saying that if it's a 1 ampere current that's flowing through this, you know, 60 times 1, there's 60 volts across this, and there's 40 volts across this. If you look at this thing here, if this is 40 volts and the voltage here is 0, delta V is 0 here. So the voltage across the capacitor, delta VC, is 40 volts as well. You see, we could have also done it that way. But anyway, here we can go from here and we can say Q max is equal to C times delta V, and C is 2 microfarads and 40 volts. So that's your 80 microcoulombs. See? So that's how you can calculate the charge, the maximum charge. Right? There is one extra part to this problem here, part B. It says now the switch is opened at T equals 0. So it was closed for a very long time. The capacitor had a maximum charge, which we found out. So I'll call it the initial charge now, because we have our initial now is T equals 0 when we open the switch, right? So initially the charge is 80 microcoulombs on the capacitor. The switch is opened at T equals 0. At what time has the charge on the capacitor decreased to 10% of the initial value? You see? So if you open the switch, the 60 ohm and the 100 volts, they are out of the circuit. So what you have now is a single capacitor that's got a lot of charge on it, 80 microcoulomb of charge on it, and that's going to discharge through a total. So if I see the thing here, you know, the current, I'll call it I, the current I is now going to go through the 10 ohm and the 40 ohms. They are now in series. So the series equivalent resistance is 50 ohms. 40 plus 10, right? So that's the current I. So this is a perfect discharge circuit, right? So for a discharge circuit, you go and grab the equation for a discharge circuit. It's on your equation sheet, Q equals QI times E to the minus T over tau, right? And what we are asked to do is to calculate the time when Q is equal to 10% of the initial charge. You see, so if I substitute it here, right, if this goes here, I have 0.1 QI equals QI times E to the minus T over tau, and the tau here is going to be RC, and the R is the, you know, 50 ohms, and C is the 2 microfarads, so the time constant is 100 microseconds, you see. So with that, we just need to solve this. So basically, you solve this for time, right? So T over tau is going to be negative natural log of 0.1, and the time will be negative natural log of 0.1 times tau, which is 100 microsecond. You see? So that's like 230 microseconds.